polyamory. Poly, many. Amory, loves. Many loves is polyamory is the definition. How that plays out depends on who's going to be busy with that. I'm sure there'll be commentary from various people who had some long-term interaction with these terms and better approaches to a discussion that is kind and is non-violent communication, bringing up issues that maybe the other person feels a little uncomfortable about, but they want to continue a long-term relationship. You have lots more opportunities to work out your differences and your similarities when there are more people involved, right? And whatever it is, an organization or close, intimate relationships. So I think I'd like to start actually with Paul.
Paul Gibbons.
Hi. I have been polyamorous for quite a number of years, since the 70s. And I discovered that, high school dating and all that stuff was very unfulfilling for me. When I came to California, I grew up in the Midwest, and I came across a number of people who were in the human potential movement. And I ended up going to like conventions of the Association of Humanistic Psychotherapy and things like that. And a lot of people with a lot of very open ideas, and I learned much thereby. And so I think that human interaction is only limited by our own sense of what's fulfilling, and I think the idea of fulfilling in others, that which we could grow in ourselves. There are no real limitations. It's just, the non-aggression principle applied to personal relationships.
So,
Nick Ford.
Yeah, hi, Nick Ford here. I guess I'll give a little bit of background on the panel and stuff like that. So about, I want to say, 2 or 3 years ago, me and my friend Justin Laws were just talking about how, maybe there should be some sort of panel on alternative sort of non-monogamous relationships or something like that. And so basically within the course of like 1 or 2 days, this was, by the way, the week of Porkfest. So the poly panel hadn't been even scheduled yet, nothing like that. And so we frantically got together whoever we could. We ended up actually overcompensating, getting like 5 or 6 people. You can find this video on YouTube. It's got over like 1,000 hits, which is like amazing. And so we scrambled, and we got me, himself, Stephanie Murphy. Paul Gibbons was there. We got a few other people. I don't really remember everyone. I think Ross Kenyon was there. And it was a great turnout. It was just organized within a few days during Porkfest. And it was a huge hit, so we brought it back for the next year, and we're here this year. Thank you to everybody who's still coming and still very much interested in this sort of conversation. My sort of very short intro, which will be even shorter because I just blathered on about something you may or may not care about, is I've been polyamorous for about 1.5 years. I've been interested in polyamory for longer than that, about maybe 2 or 3 years. And it started when I was, it was actually my friend Justin who I was talking to, and he was telling me about this book called The Ethical Slut. And I don't remember the author's names, but it's a really, really essential book for understanding polyamory. And I read it, and I was just hooked on the idea. At the time, I was in a monogamous relationship, so I couldn't explore the ideas that I wanted to. But I was very interested in them. I kept reading about them and talking about them with other people. That's mostly it in terms of my intro.
Hi guys, I'm Lauren Rumpler, aka Objectivist Girl. I've been talking lately with Kathy Reisowitz about polyamory the morality of sex recently, and I've been interested in polyamory for almost 1 year now. It started out as a way that I could keep my long-distance relationship in Indiana going, and then I ended up falling in love with my partner. And I think that's really when it became polyamorous and not just, something I was doing to feed a physical desire that I had when I wasn't with my partner. And so I discovered that I'm capable of being polyamorous maybe about 7 months ago. And that was really fulfilling and awesome. And my personal view is, as an objectivist, I think that love is a mutually beneficial relationship between two people, and love is entirely selfish. And you can love more than one person because everybody displays different values. And you can value more than one person at a time. I mean, look at friendship. And I think that a romantic relationship holds a deeper connection, and I want to be able to have that with several people, and that's what drew me to it.
I also really want to thank Kevin Innes, because originally this panel was just me and him, and so he thought he had the good thinking to get Paul Gibbons, who I should have invited but didn't think to, and as well as Lauren, who I wouldn't have thought of. So thank you to Kevin Innes for making this panel two times better.
One, two.
Yeah, another term for polyamory is ethical non-monogamy. How to do it in an ethical way. We want to be kind, we want to do a way that addresses our inner ethics, and we would like to do it in ways that is open and honest, without this failure in many people's lives that they've been married, and it's been a failed marriage because it ended. It was successful all the time it lasted. I know a fellow friend of mine said, yeah, I've been married 30 years to three different women. So it's like serial monogamy, one after another, you know? And what happens after you've had a relationship for a long time that's been very intimate, there's this hardship, and it's like you don't even know how to interact in kind ways like you used to before. Non-sexually, right? You can still have, I mean, I still love many of the women that I once had relationships with, but there's this tension that's there because we can't be intimate, then we better have no contact at all. It's such a hot topic, right? So we're going to talk a little bit more, how is it, what type of conversations need to take place in case one person starts to find that they're attracted to another and would like to have more than just a friendship that says hello and a shake of hands. You know, I'd like to cuddle with them. Maybe not have sex. I'd like to cuddle at least, but I'm not closed to sex either. Right? How to have that conversation in ways that's ethical. Paul.
Yeah, it's interesting that you, ethics, I think, is a foundation of all this. And I've recently came across a gentleman who has got an interesting definition of ethics, which is basically the goal that you wish to achieve, a happy life, a good sex life, or whatever, and then a belief about what action would bring about that goal. And so an ethic is something that, if you apply it, you know, it's those two qualities together. And how you know it's a valid ethic is if you apply the action that you believe achieves the goal, you'll achieve the goal. That's a valid ethic. Many of us have a belief that if you, you know, take a particular action, you'll achieve a desired goal, but it doesn't work. That's an invalid ethic. And I think it's important, society puts out rules for us that they call ethics and morals, but if you apply the actions that they say that you should do, you never quite arrive at the happy life you wanted. So I think it's important for us to recognize that there are invalid ethics in our culture, and I think one of the things that we can do as liberty activists and as polyamorists is to examine these, you know, these assumptions and go, well, does this action produce the goal I want? Is it a valid ethic? And I think if we wish to respect ourselves and respect our fellow human beings, it behooves us to do the thinking and to do the communicating and to find out who that other person is that you're having a relationship and what goals they want and what actions would go towards achieving the, you know, the life that they wanted. Find common ground and you share, and so to me, there shouldn't be any locked doors in any human relationship. It should be just what the people themselves can negotiate, what the people themselves wish to explore, and that should be anything.
And there's a lot of ethics in this current culture that we kind of take for granted. I think, for example, the sort of ethic of, or sort of the idea of monogamy as a sort of standard or cultural norm, is way overblown, and I think it's also really taken for granted. And a lot of people, I think, confuse non-monogamy with cheating, So I think that there's a good reason to sort of talk about, maybe instead of using the word polyamory, although I don't have anything against using that word, you can also use ethical non-monogamy, because lots of people just sort of conflate non-monogamous relationships with, spouses who cheat or, all these sort of things that happen. So I think that there are sort of ethics that are valid for certain individuals. Certainly polyamory doesn't work for everyone, nor should it really. But I do think that if non-monogamous ethical sort of alternatives are better understood and they're actually known about, I think more people would actually freely choose them. That's obviously my own personal speculation, but I think it would bear out.
So one of the things in doing my channel is to help people question the standard of ethics in our society. And often those standards are pro other people versus pro ourselves. And objectivism turns that on its head and says that your responsibility is a rational self-interest and also a respect for other people. And so what I like about polyamory or ethical non-monogamy is that it says that your contract is not to be intimate with only one person. Your contract is the promise that you make with a person. And if you both agreed that polyamory or ethical non-monogamy or monogamy is the appropriate answer to your relationship, then you're holding true to your ethics as long as you're always honest to what you say you're going to do. And that's what the couple has decided, and that's why I find it ethical.
What type of relationship can you create with, a number of people when there isn't jealousy involved? When you have a source of fulfillment within yourself that's not dependent on the other person? Love is something you are responsible as much as your hate or jealousy or anything else. Nobody makes you those things, right? It's a core principle of nonviolent communication: own up to your feelings. So what are those sources of jealousy? Inadequacy, feeling of abandonment, all these different things. You can't be with the one you love anyway, so what is it? Love the one you're with, right? It's not the right time. Why prevent yourself from actions and expressions of a connectedness you feel with one another, right? And if there's a contract that you've made with somebody, okay, but it only goes so far and you both agreed on it, okay, well, stick to it. That's a good idea. And it's good to have these conversations, but I would like to bring up that component, especially. How do you deal, or how can you mitigate jealousy cropping up in a relationship, especially in a polyamorous relationship?
I'm sorry, do you want to give it a Paul?
Yeah, jealousy is something that is sold to us in our culture that we're supposed to have. And all of the stories about how romantic relationships are supposed to go are steeped in this idea that it's supposed to be exclusive, and you're supposed to get really upset with your partner if they even think about someone else. And I'm not sure that's, I'm not sure that's natural, okay? People sell it, well, that's human nature. But if it's so human nature, why does it have to be sold to us so strongly, okay? I've done a collection of little comic strips, okay? And it just strikes me how many times in the comic pages that violence is talked about as a matter of quote-unquote infidelity. It's like, it's this thing that keeps being sold to us over and over again. And I think if we could step back and disconnect ourselves from the propaganda and go, how do we really feel? Jealousy is just fear, okay? You care about somebody, they're important to you. You've invested a lot of emotional energy into a relationship, and then they seem to be interested in someone else, and it's like this fear comes up, oh my God, they're going to go away, I can't take this, I must stop that, right? And so the culture says you have a right to go in there and demand, But if you just stop and listen to the other person, okay, they may be interested in someone else. That doesn't mean they stop being interested in you, okay? One of the things about polyamorous relationships that's a lot of fun is something called new relationship energy, okay? you meet somebody and it's like, wow, the fireworks go off and oh, it's just great, and the endorphins are flowing and you're just, you know, totally in the zone, right? And, you know, then you build on that and you have a relationship and you may even live together, you know, you may have a lot invested in each other. And then they meet someone else. And what's really nice, what I've really enjoyed about some relationships I've had is to watch them have that whole thing going, okay? Watch them just light up and have all the fireworks with someone else and just enjoy their fun, okay? And they bring that energy back home and say, oh, I had this fantastic time, and, you know, and, you know, a lot of times we're all end up being all together in the same place. So, you know, we can all enjoy, you know. To me, it's all positive unless somebody makes it negative, you know. So why make it negative?
So yeah, so a few things, or one thing before I comment on the jealousy thing. I welcome people who are standing outside, because I feel bad for you guys, especially if it starts raining, to come, you know, yeah, do a come down the side and stuff like that, you know.
If you're gonna stand, stand in here.
Yeah, I don't want you guys, you know, getting rained on or whatever. Yeah. So I mean, if you're interested enough, I'm not trying to force you into the polyamory thing we got going on. So, oh, did I say that poorly? Whoops. So anyway, so just want to make sure everybody's good. So on the jealousy thing, yeah. So I'm not sure that jealousy is just fear. I mean, I kind of agree with the authors of The Ethical Slut that jealousy just seems to me some amorphous sort of bundle of sort of different feelings that we have. I definitely think fear is a big part of it. I wouldn't deny that. And I also want to comment that you know, polyamorous people aren't robots. Like we do feel jealousy. Like it's not like we're some sort of new breed of humans, and we don't feel jealousy at all. I can tell you firsthand that, you know, I definitely I've had jealous experiences in polyamorous relationships that were totally irrational, rational, something in between. But I've definitely had them, and they're not any more fun just because you have more people involved. Sometimes they're less fun. I think that's all I had to say about that.
Yeah, I just want to start off by saying, I mean, you're going to always have a high level of emotions with somebody you really care about. So jealousy is one of those things that's going to crop up. It's about how you deal with it. So I want to do a little exercise. I always talk about golden water. And who in the audience, yeah, I know, some of you know me and know I do this thing, but who in the audience, who in the audience thinks that gold is more important than water? Raise your hand. Okay, who in the audience thinks water is more important? Okay, now, think about this. What if there's a surplus of water and a shortage of gold? Now, isn't gold more important? No? Okay.
We See, already have a more. Surplus of
this
water.
This didn't work.
it's called the polar ice cap.
The point I'm trying to make is that in some situations we need gold, and in some situations we need water. And I like to think about my partners and my partner's partners as gold and water. So when I'm feeling jealous, I say right now, I'm gold and they need water, or I'm water and they need gold. And it's not about them not caring about me anymore. It's that different partners fulfill different needs for us in our lives. And so you have to look, it's not a difference in value. It's not that they value one more or less, it's that they value them differently. And that's what you are trying to look at when you're looking at a polyamorous relationship and when you're dealing with jealousy, is remember, they still love you. It's that they also love someone else.
Right, and that you bring that then to a relationship. You know, the world is rose-colored glasses kind of when you're in love, right? Especially that early puppy love type stuff. And there's something called the State of Grace document. Maureen McCarthy does it. I think you can find it online. And it's about talking about creating something. It's nice to have it on paper, nice and clear. How is it that you would resolve differences when they came up? You know, really serious ones. Some people want to be talked to immediately. Some, no, gotta be tomorrow, you know, or give it a week before we come back to this. If it's really serious. But then to make a commitment to actually do it. And what is the conflict resolution style that you use? So the and when those jealousy issues come up. So, was there another point yet?
Yeah. Actually, I kind of want to make a comment about contracts and stuff like that, because I know how much libertarians love contracts. I've personally used sort of a negotiation kind of thing with relationships every so often. Me and my partner, we've done this twice now. We would have a sort of a conversation about, you know, how we felt about the relationship, where is stuff going, being very explicit about it. That helped us realize, you know, how we're feeling and where we are. So I think stuff like that is actually really important, and I'm not sure how many people do that. I don't really know, but I do think it's an important sort of thing to go through, is to have a sort of large, you know, wide open discussion about, you know, hey, how are you feeling about the relationship? Are there certain things you change, or, you know, are you feeling uncomfortable about this thing that I did last week, or, you know, whatever. So I think, you know, not necessarily contracts, but I do think that that kind of negotiation kind of thing could be helpful. It's been helpful to me anyway.
Yeah, actually, that's one of the other things that I wanted to point out, is that communication is key. If you look at all the studies, communication is what makes or breaks a couple. And I find that in a polyamorous relationship, it actually forces you to have those tough conversations, because otherwise it's not going to work. So when you're in a polyamorous relationship, you're actually over-talking and over-communicating instead of under-communicating, which is what dissolves many relationships. And I found that this polyamorous bond between my partners and I strengthens our relationship because of the tough conversations. We really get down to understanding one another in a way that I never did in a monogamous relationship. Not to say that monogamous relationships can't be very fulfilling. I want to be very clear about that.
So we'll be asking for questions in a couple of minutes. Just want to bring up one other very sensitive topic: children. The basic unit, how the responsibilities that you've already create, you know, joint responsibilities for property and for children and for other things that are important to both of you. How do you continue that on, even though you have other people that are involved with you in an intimate way?
Yeah, the major, for one thing, children thrive on the more adult role models they have, okay? I think it's really important to model what being a human being is for a child. And the more different role models they get, the more different qualities and styles that they can interact with. I know many people who grew up in polyamorous households, and they all say it was so nice having, you know, Uncle, you know, Artie and Uncle Steve and Aunt, you know, I mean, you know, the names, you know, the titles are less important. These were family members who helped raise them. And I think this is an important thing, living in community. Children can thrive on this. And also, they can become part of the, you know, the communication process. They learn how people work these things out, okay? There's so many times in monogamous relationships, there's so many supposed to's attached to it, that people don't really challenge, you know, the status quo, and they just think that, well, that's just the way things are. In a poly relationship, you know, there's no, you know, there's no boilerplate to work from, so you've got to work out everything from scratch, and this gives you the flexibility. And children can see how adults work things out. This is how you teach children, this is how you negotiate. This is how you respect everybody else's rights. This is how you get your needs met. This is how you respect other people's needs. I think children in a poly relationship, I think it's a great way to raise kids. However, there's one thing, the proviso here is that if you're living in this general society with the state, you have to be very careful sometimes, because your children, especially if your children are not homeschooled, can be a trigger for all kinds of aggression, and so that's something you need to make sure that you can insulate yourself from.
Yeah, I mean, I don't have too terribly many things, much less informative things, to say about children and polyamory. It's not a subject I've really delved in, because personally I don't have too much of an interest in children as that sort of thing. That sounds bad out of context, but I put it in context. So hopefully, children, whatever. I think that Paul is right. I think that polyamorous relationships help children develop better because there's more people to sort of be in these sort of mutually beneficial sort of parental relationships with. But again, I don't have too much to say about it. So
I'm not going to pretend to be an authority on this. I don't even want kids myself. But I think it's really just about if I give my two cents on it. I think it's about communicating who wants to be involved in the kid's life and at what level. And I think it's just a decision that has to be made among the people in the polyamorous relationship. And I think, again, it just goes back to communication, and communication is key. You can have any kind of relationship you want as long as it's voluntary and everyone understands all of the contracts and promises.
In some ways, it may even facilitate that because, hey, relationships do come and go. And if children are there, they're there for a long time. And so how to continue to have a meaningful relationship with your child's other parent, right? Even though you're not in a relationship anymore, you can still not have that jealousy issue come up. You've already been talking about that from before, or you know how to deal with the fact that former lover is with somebody else now. You know, hey, so you are or you're not. Okay, you've already had conversations, and it can be supportive in that, and supportive in that child continuing to grow in an environment with somebody else as being that person's intimate partner. So that level of communication starting early and continuing all the way through the child's life is so important. So I think I'm going to open this up for questions from the audience. Now, when you do speak, the way we have it right now, the microphone does not come through the speaker, but it is being recorded for our purposes. So when you speak up, okay? Go ahead.
Since I already have it, I'm going to ask.
First.
There you go.
How do your non-involved partners interact with each other if they do? So if you have two different partners who are not involved with each other, how do they interact?
Non-involved at
with
the time.
Other, yeah.
If the non-involved relationships, how do they interact with one another is the question. Who'd like to answer?
Like in Lauren's case, your two partners, are they involved with each other? If not, how do they interact?
Well, at the moment, I am only with one person, but the relationship in Indiana ended, unfortunately. But they wanted to meet each other. Unfortunately, they never had an opportunity to interact. But I think that in an ideal situation, of course, everybody's friends and everybody's just happy for one another that they're getting their needs met. And of course, that's ideal and that's not always going to happen. But in a really good polyamorous relationship, everybody's friends and everybody's just happy to see their partners getting their needs met. So, yeah.
Yeah, so, I mean, I was in a polyamorous relationship that had me and I was with someone and then someone else with my partner, so it was like a triangle or whatever. Clearly I'm not good with shapes. Wasn't that funny. Sorry, I'm trying to refocus. So I was friends with the other person, so we were good friends. I think there's this term, I think it's called metamour or something like that. It's not the person you're in a relationship with, but your partner's partner sort of deal. So in terms of that, I mean, I was friends with him and we had a decent relationship in terms of just being friends and, you know, and all that. So I do agree with Lauren for sure that, you know, friendship is very important to have all around. But then again, there's also these fuzzy lines with relationships in polyamory, especially because, for example, you can have your partner have friend-mantic relationships where you're friends and you're kind of romantically interested, but there's no solid commitment. You don't see each other all the time, and there's no real way for your maybe this is a bad way of phrasing it, but your main partner to see these other people. So there's different ways to sort of deal with these arrangements, and they're not always ideal, and they're not always perfect. Luckily for me, I was already friends with the guy, so you know, it worked out in that way okay enough.
Yeah, it's important to at least have a, I personally like to know more about the people that's in my significant other's life, you know. Now, of course, you know, we were both bi, so, you know, we many times got involved, you know, all the way, you know, but there were some times where they were just good friends, and, but this is, you know, it's important, yeah, metamor, that's, I can't remember who coined that term, it's a good one. But yeah, the more, you know, you can learn about each other, you know, because the kind of person that my significant other, I mean, I was married for 14 years, and, you know, she, you know, enjoyed it when I was able to connect with her other lovers. And, but I think it's a good thing, you know, I like to know who my significant other is, you know, why are you interested in this person? They must have some value. I want to find out who they are, you know, so it's all about, you know, human contact and learning about each other. It's just another opportunity to have some fun and learn more about ourselves.
Was there another question out there? Yeah.
I have two great questions, so I'm not going to pass the mic until I ask both. My first question is, what are the pros and cons of different information disclosure policy? Like, my favorite is don't ask, do tell. It's important for lots of reasons, like including but not limited to full knowledge of like STD risks. Are other policies valid?
So, I guess since I already have the mic. Yeah, I get kind of nervous/suspicious about people who want sort of contracts like, you know, don't tell me about who you're seeing. Is that what you're talking about? I think that's what you're talking about.
That, yeah.
Yeah, okay. I just want to make sure I'm understanding right. Yeah, I mean, if someone who I was dating wanted to have a relationship, a poly relationship specifically, where we wouldn't talk about who we were with or they didn't want to get to know them, I'd be kind of uncomfortable with that personally. I think people should just kind of be connected. I think that just makes everything work better and smoother. It helps us understand ourselves, like I think Paul was talking about before, and it helps us understand our partners and other people. I mean, I just think there's so many pros to that I don't think I'd be comfortable with that sort of policy. So I don't know about any other policies off the top of my head, but I'll just comment on that one because it came to mind.
I'll say I do like both parts of that. I like the don't ask, because you can't own anyone, and I mean, we're all libertarians, so we all agree with that. You can't own anyone, so of course you shouldn't be asking. Telling is very important because, you know, all of the risks that he just highlighted. And also, but I think that it goes further than that. I think that in a really good, open, honest, communicative relationship, you would have a conversation first before you added any partners. I find that it would avoid a lot of problems that way, and it makes you aware of some of the feelings that they may have afterwards and some that they're having up front. Because it's important to constantly be dealing with each other's insecurity issues, so.
Yeah, as I mentioned, that you can call whatever, some Nick Tall calls in negotiations or some discussion about things, how to resolve conflicts in advance, you know, and that could be one of them. If you do, maybe you have a one-on-one relationship and it comes around, you've met somebody, how do you deal with that, you know? How much disclosure would you feel comfortable with, right? Some people don't. And, of course, we're open to change the level of information that we want to receive about that other partner. And I think that's, it comes down to knowing yourself and being able to have those skills that you've developed about how to draw it out from others in a open-ended way, you know, without trying to force the information out of them. You had another point also?
We should get
No, I basically concur with what they say. I think it's really important to have, you know, the more you feel like you have to hide or not disclose, then that's an indicator of something that probably you should be working on internally. So if I find myself uncomfortable wanting to share something with my partner, I'm going, okay, what's that all about? And then I will communicate, hey, I'm feeling uncomfortable about telling you this, and then I'll tell her that, and then we'll have a discussion about it. You know, I think that, to me, that makes the relationship more vital, and it serves both of our interests, and that we become better people.
Another question.
Yeah.
My second question is, do you use the labels primary, secondary, etc.? I told you they were good questions, but other people were going to ask them.
I didn't doubt you.
If you do use them, do you use them intentionally, or do they just sort of happen? If you try not to use them, what other words do you prefer?
Okay, so we'll repeat questions, you know, so nobody needs to tell anybody to speak up if they can. The question is basically, do we use the terms primary, secondary, and tertiary sort of partners or relationships? If we do, why? If we don't, why not? Etc. So personally, I haven't really had to, because my polyamorous relationship is just with one person who is also seeing a lot of other people in various ways. So I haven't had to really do that. But if I did, if I had that opportunity, I probably wouldn't. I feel like prioritizing people in relationships, I mean, there are definitely some instances, thank you, where it's good to give more attention to somebody, you know, especially if they're feeling left out, or they're feeling like their needs aren't being met, or they feel, or they're just, you know, they're long distance and they're coming to visit or something like that. So I do think that there's situations in which we can prioritize, but systematically speaking, I'm not really comfortable with prioritizing one person over another. This isn't to say, you know, it doesn't work for everyone, but personally I'm a little bit uncomfortable creating this sort of relationship hierarchy within, you know, we should have anarchy, so, you know. No hierarchy, man, no hierarchy.
Sure. So I have been in interesting relationships ever since I moved to New Hampshire, one being a long distance. But for me, I do use kind of the hierarchy system in an odd way. I really don't label secondary or tertiary. I do have a primary, but for me, primary means the person that I spend the most time with and the person that I communicate the most with. It's basically... it's an unnecessary label, but at the same time, for me, it helps me kind of organize the way that I think about the relationship. But it's different for everybody.
Yes, that it's, you personalize it. Have that talk. Right. What is it that other person needs? What is it that you need? And does that person need that acknowledgement that they're the main person in their life? Or is it just going to be acknowledged by the amount of time you actually spend with them? Right? That's the most proof. Hey, love, expression of love is being there, right? That comes in many forms. Even if you're not physically present, having regular contact, you know, through various means, and sharing your most intimate parts of yourself with that other person, and that could change, you know. But it doesn't mean that you're going to drop that relationship. I think it comes from that sense of insecurity that what if I allow them to associate with others, then I'm going to lose them, right? Sometimes that's what causes the relationship to fall apart, because you're too clingy, right? You've made this classification as being the main thing that holds the relationship together. Or the fact, well, we have kids, so we can't divorce, or whatever it is. You can't see anybody else, you know? I had a situation where, you know, I was not having an intimate relationship with my wife. We were fine friendship-wise and had children. He said, you know, maybe you should find a lover. I said, what? What's this about? You know, now what? You know? Well, she had this spiritual thing that she, her ideal was that her guru's parents had sex once a year to have children. Oh, really? We already had two. Did I sign up for this? So that's what started me. I didn't say much earlier, but that's what kind of started me that, hey, you know, maybe it would be appropriate to have other relationships. But wouldn't you know it, she got jealous after I actually found a wonderful person. So much for that idea. So we tried to work things out, and then over the course of time, it's just, you realize you wouldn't be able to handle that type of relationships because we didn't have that closer, deeper conversation. And of course, being able to draw that out and knowing oneself and the other to see if that's going to work or not. Right? So it really depends on how you set things up first. Paul, would you like to?
Yeah, this is an issue that I've been looking at recently, this whole idea of hierarchical versus egalitarian relationships. And I'm thinking that my ex-wife was very hierarchical. I mean, she had, you know, I was primary, and, you know, she wanted me to be, you know, her to be my prime, you know, it's like, and it did create friction in the relationship. You know, she was very committed to poly, but, you know, she was all about, you know, ranking and, you know, and the proper place and all this stuff. And I was much more, hey, you know, just let it flow, right? So I'm with a lady now who's very much, you know, she considers me to be her primary, and she's not particularly interested in finding other relationships right now. And so she's having to deal with the fact that I still, you know, have interest in other people. But, you know, she's very open and very accepting about it. And like you, Nick, I'm not real comfortable with this labeling thing. You know, there was a talk here earlier in this TED about deconstructing labels. And I think that's really important to really, you know, get in touch with the feelings about, you know, what is this hierarchical thing all about? And kind of deconstruct that and find out what your needs really are, and then discuss those instead of putting a label on it. So.
Okay, next question.
It's on. You're just
not in the PA. We'll repeat the question. Don't worry.
I have a kind of two-part question. Generally, how do people enter and exit a polyamorous relationship? And what is the normal size of such a group? Just generally.
Okay. So the questions were, how do people exit polyamorous relationships?
Enter and exit.
Sorry. And what's the normal size of a given poly relationship? So, going to do a statistical poll right now. No. There's not a lot of... there's not a lot of information. I mean, as far as I know, anyway, I could be totally wrong, but there's not a lot of information in terms of that second question, so I don't know exactly how to answer that.
What would I guess?
So I don't know, maybe 3 to 4? 3 to 4. I'm just going to say 3 to 4. Just going to throw that out there. 3 to 4. That's a statistical average right there, so says me. So how do people enter and exit? Sometimes they're not much more glamorous than the way people enter and exit monogamous relationships. Sometimes they're worse. I hate to kind of give this cop-out answer, but I mean, it really does differ for any given poly relationship. I mean, for me and my partner, it's a matter of just getting to know the person, talking to them, saying, oh yeah, you know, they're cool, you know, I don't mind you dating them. And I mean, that's pretty much it. There's not a lot of barriers to entry, so to speak. that was not a sexual joke. Damn it. I was trying to make a libertarian joke, not a sexual joke. I can't do anything with you people. So anyway. So that's pretty much done. Sorry.
I think we have another question here.
Yeah, so as someone who is sort of, I guess, poly-curious would be the... I don't know of another term to use, but, you know, like somebody who is kind of interested but not really sure of, is there any way other than just the standard, you know, like asking somebody out thing that you would do to ask someone out who is already in a poly relationship, if that makes any sense?
Well, I was watching recently, and you can find it on YouTube, very interesting discussion. Polyamory experts discuss polyamory, and they get into a lot of those different points about what sort of questions to ask. One guy said, dating my species. You know, in other words, dating polyamorists himself. Totally changed it. Totally changed how it was, because before he was trying to get along with two that wanted to just have a one-on-one, right? And as soon as he started dating poly folks, it was so much more relaxing and better for him, right? And so, as far as finding out about that, you ask the question, but I'm also organizing something called a cuddle party, okay, for those who like to be around those who are friendly. This is non-sexual. And I'll just read a couple things off. The cuddle party rules are tried and true, and there's a logic to them. Goes deeper in the surface impressions, okay? And the first part of it is you explain what the rules are, which is, you know, like you arrive on time, pajamas, nothing risque, more comfy than sexy, more drawstrings than lace, no shorts, okay? You know, alcohol or drugs, okay? Pillow or stuffed animal, and now pajamas stay on the whole time. You know, you don't have to cuddle with anyone at a cuddle party either, ever. Ask permission and get a verbal yes. If you're a no, say no. If you are a maybe, say no. If you're encouraged to, and you're encouraged to change your mind, respect your relationship agreements with your, respect your agreements with those significant others in your life, you know, and talk with your partner first. Cuddle party facilitator is there for questions and concerns and any assistance, and there's tears and laughter, both are welcome. Respect people's privacy when sharing about the cuddle party itself, and keep the cuddle space tidy. So if you're interested in any, you know, I'm going to put one on, and you can come up and talk with me afterwards about that. So having that conversation, finding out how you are, I like to talk with people, those significant others that I have, and they find a new relationship, one of my first questions is, what's the jealousy index, right? How do they respond when you give somebody, if you both meet, a big hug or maybe a kiss? How do they respond afterwards? You know, find out where that's at and see if that will work out for you.
I'd like to address that question because it's important, because most people in our culture still have this belief that, you know, monogamy is the one and poly is cheating. So in order to meet poly people, and it's easier and easier all the time because of the internet, you know, find a group of poly people, okay, so that you can introduce yourself to them. At least you know, you know, they're not going to run away screaming if you suggest the idea of having a relationship that isn't, you know, monogamous marriage. That's my idea. You know, my ex and I ran a poly meetup group for years. A support group for people interested in poly. Just come to the house, and we had discussions and things. You know, no, it wasn't like a swinging party. There was no sex going on, but it was a discussion, a way to meet people and talk through this stuff. So find a support group if you're interested, you know, curious, you know, find a support group in your area or start one, you know, hey, interested in having meetings about people interested in poly, come over to my house, you know. That's one way you can get started.
You're not alone. Look at people who are at least curious, right? Thank you.
Okay, so next question.
Okay, so an integral part of polyamory is kind of liberation and sexual liberation. But there's something that's been coming up with some people in the community that I have kind of questions about, which is essentially ideas in regards to age of consent. I'd kind of like to know Nick Ford's view in regards to this, because I've been told that a little bit of a liberal view of this.
What? I have no idea what you're talking about. I don't know what the hell you're talking about. Oh, so it's sort of a question about age of consent, and apparently I have a liberal view on it. I don't know what he's talking about, but I mean, I dated someone who was like, I don't know, like a junior in high school. I was a freshman in college. Like, I guess it's 2 or 3 years, like a liberal view on age of consent. I don't know, but I don't know. So I don't know what you're talking about. I don't know what else to say about that.
Yes, there are very strict rules that, you know, you want nice to avoid sticky situations that are, you know, you have the authorities down your throat or your parents or whatever. So you exercise caution, you know, all I can say about, you know, age of consent. And if you do get consent from the parents, then it's different, right? I mean, Texas, can't you get married at 13 or something, 14?
Texas is
Texas.
It's 117. Parental consent.
Contact your local attorney.
So that's a legal issue. We're talking more. Yeah.
No, I was just kind of wondering the views in regards to that.
Yeah.
Fuck the whole one about the ethics behind it.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's
a good question.
It's
outside the scope of the panel.
Yeah.
Well, polyamory does not need to have a sexual relationship in order to be a polyamorous relationship. Would you agree?
Yeah.
I have many relationships that are not sexual at all. I sleep with them, we cuddle, that's it. Have for years. It's wonderful. You know? So that type of relationship with those age of consent would not be a problem unless there's some lies that are being told about what went on, you know. And that's a problem. He said, she said, can they even testify because they're underage, you know. It gets awkward, you know.
What's the best way for a man to persuade...
Finish the question.
Yes.
Like, persuade?
I didn't come up against these entrenched memes, and yeah. I just noticed that, well, since I've only dated women, I've only known, I mean, I think that they're more entrenched with women, I think, you know, so what's the best way to deal with, you know, the perception from the woman that, well, you know, she should just be with one person, and that's really kind of drilled into their heads when they're young, and also the assumption that, you know, as a guy, me asking her this, that it's me wanting to be promiscuous and that it's just some like fucking chuck thing and just, you know, some disposability, you know, I just want to be like a male slut or whatever. That it's really about like, you know, the different tool for different jobs. So like some women I might want to travel with and some I might want to have some other hobby to be able to find.
Okay.
When I bring it up, they're always skeptical.
Right. So your question is basically how to persuade women that this isn't the wrong idea. And my response to that would be, as a woman, I have found that there are men that are just as close-minded as women. So I don't think this is a sex issue or a gender issue, but it's a people issue. You have to have an intense amount of self-awareness to be able to have the kind of maturity that it takes to engage in these kinds of relationships. They are not easy. We are not trying to say that they are easy. We're still trying to figure them out. But that's just the thing. You're gonna have complications in a monogamous relationship. If anyone tells you that they should just be with one person, you should question the word should and ask them what it is that they really want for themselves, not what society wants for them.
The Ethical Slut has a chapter specifically on opening up relationships that exist already.
Hey everybody, I'm Tony.
He's been on our panels before.
I've been on the panel in the past. I don't know if anybody you know have met me before. I've been actively practicing poly for about 15 years, give or take, where I've had two women live with me for almost all of them. This is something that I've seen the ups and downs, the lefts and rights of all of this at some point. First of all, you don't convince somebody or you persuade them. You can't lead a horse to water and then make them drink. I mean, they kind of have to do it on their own.
Go ahead. Let me interject. What if, you know, parallel universe, this person with like their genome or whatever, you know, there's no hereditary reason that in some parallel universe, under the right environmental circumstances, how she was raised, that she would not reject that. So, you know, in midlife, like 20s or 30s, how do you take this person? And,
well, I think you're approaching it the wrong way.
There's no inherent bar to that person doing it.
All right.
But there's just the environmental.
Here's a secret question, I guess, is to ask is, what if you're platonically in love with somebody? I mean, what if you're in a platonic relationship with somebody and you're in love with them? How do you persuade them to be in love with you? You can't. It's not something you can force. And the same thing, this is almost in a third person kind of way, you can't persuade them to be okay with the situation or fall in love with that said other person or whatever. it has to kind of flow naturally. And the root of this is not even sex or even poly. In fact, this applies to even mono relationships. You have to have communication. Communication is key right from the get-go. You have to be able to have an open conversation and say, you know, that woman over there, I'm just finding very attractive, we're intellectual, we're getting along on such and such subjects. If you're having that dialogue right from the get-go, even before you're discussing poly, even before it's a forethought, that's how it flows naturally. But if you jump from, oh, this girl's hot, I really want to get with her, or I want to do this, well, how do I make my wife okay with it? You're kind of like jumping like several steps in between. I mean, you got to think like way back, even if you're just dating, you don't want to like just jump in the sack with somebody. You've actually got to, you know, have a, build a relationship first. And that's the, you have to have a foundation before you have a long-lasting relationship. Otherwise, your relationship will be less measured in days. My relationships are measured in, oh, half a decade, 5 years, 6 years, 10 years. I don't have relationships that last for a weekend. You have to make sure that you're thinking long-term.
I also just want to say, we only have a few more minutes. I'm sorry we can't get to everyone's questions. I think also we should end this line of dialogue and let somebody else ask a question, not to be rude. And Paul also has something to say, too.
Yeah, I just wanted to say that if you are trying to pursue someone who is not really compatible with what the kind of relationship you're looking for, then maybe you look within yourself to see why am I pursuing this person who's not really, you know, with the program, you know. So do some looking inside to find out why you're doing this.
Also, I just want to ask a question. So we've been having poly panels for a few years now, and obviously they're still very, very popular, which is awesome. I'm interested if people would come to a more general panel of alternative non-monogamous relationships, so that would mean things like, I don't know, swinging or open marriages and stuff like that, instead of just polyamory. I think that would, I think it would be better to have it more, I don't know, diverse. Would you still come to that? Okay, cool. That's what I'm thinking for next year. Instead of just a poly panel, have a more general non-monogamous relationship panel.
Or an addition.
I think you should do at least two panels. That way people can see that there's separate types of entities.
We can talk about this off talk. Let's have one last question and then wrap it up there. Sorry, we can't get to everybody.
I'm wondering, what's your definition of love, and does it change from partner to partner?
Oh, good. Okay, a good quick question. Good. Easy question. A good easy question. Good. We're only defining love. Fantastic. Lauren's so ready for this, and I am so ready too. And let me just explain to you how ready I am.
Oh, you don't want to explain objectivism? Okay, I will. Okay. Objectivist girl is going to go on an objectivist rant, and this, of course, is going to be different from for everyone. Yes, very briefly. So I touched on it a little bit at the beginning, but I view love as rationally self-interested, and how you do that is you search for your values in other people, and that's why I think that polyamory is compatible with objectivism, is because you are searching for your values in other people. And I don't truly think that you can find all of your values in one person. I would love to be proven wrong, but in my rational self-interest, I find relationships with different people that fulfill different needs and desires that I have, and it's all consensual. And love for me is that rational self-interested pursuit of values.
And actually, I guess I'll take back what I said. I'll say something really brief. I come from more of a mutualistic sort of position on it. I think self-interest is very much important, but I think the sort of self-interest is based on sort of reciprocity and sort of norms surrounding that. I don't want to go into it too much, both because of time and, you know, other restraining factors. So,
two definitions that of this that I really enjoyed. One is by Robert Heinlein, who says, "Love is that condition by which the happiness of another is essential to your own." And Stefan Molyneux, who says that love is the involuntary response to virtue.
Yes.
So those work for me.
And to address the part of the question that had to do with quantifying who you would love more or differently or whatever, I'll leave you with this, and it's very simple. Do you have two parents? Most of us do. Which parent do you love more? Or inversely, if you have two children, which child do you love more? You love them all. You love them differently, but you still love them just the same.
So I think that'll... Kevin!
I want to talk about love as well. Yeah, it's a topic close to my heart. For me, love is connectedness. You could be with them in close proximity or far away. The time and distance doesn't matter. You still have that connection with them. They may be here. They may be already gone. You know, may have died, right? Or somewhere else. So that love is connectedness, something that you feel you're responsible for, your own love. It has nothing to do with the other person. You're the one feeling it, after all. Hey, own up to it. You've connected with them some way. Maybe they don't show much of that towards you, but that doesn't matter. You can still feel it. It's up to you.
So that about does it. Thanks, everybody, for coming for another year of Polyamory.